John Nash shaped the most influential theory of rational human behavior, only to spiral into irrationality, tormented by schizophrenia. But somehow he recovered and won a Nobel Prize. This is the story of the brilliant mathematician who descended into madness and found his way back. For John Nash, life was a series of rational choices free from emotion. What to eat, who to marry. Yet beneath the surface of his orderly mind lay chaos. During his illness, he believed he had been recruited by aliens to save the world. He thought extraterrestrials were communicating with him through encrypted messages in the New York Times. He became obsessed with men in red ties, believing they were sending him covert signals. Even dogs walking by seemed like spies following him. There was nothing in his upbringing that hinted at the mental illness that would consume him. Born on June 13, 1928, Nash grew up in Bluefield, West Virginia, in a loving, stable home. His father, John Sr., was an electrical engineer, and his mother, Virginia, was a teacher. They nurtured his education. His best friends were books, including the encyclopedia his parents gifted him. His parents were concerned about his social awkwardness and encouraged his younger sister, Martha, to include him in their activities. Although his parents were educated, neither had a background in math. The turning point came in high school when he discovered Men of Mathematics, a classic book that inspired him to tackle complex math problems. While he fell in love with math, he intended to follow his father's footsteps and study chemical engineering at Carnegie Institute of Technology, now Carnegie Mellon. But Nash hated engineering, especially mechanical drawing, and soon switched to chemistry, only to hate it too, recalling, "It was not a matter of how well one could think and understand or learn facts, but of how well one could handle a pipette and perform a titration in the laboratory." The head of Carnegie's math department, John Singh, recognized Nash's potential and encouraged him to switch his major to mathematics. Though Nash doubted he could make a career out of math, his professors persuaded him it was possible. Although he was brilliant, Nash failed to rank in the top five in the prestigious Putnam math competition for undergraduates, which he believed hurt his chances of receiving a better offer from Harvard for grad school. Princeton, however, was eager to have him, offering a full scholarship covering tuition, housing, and meals. Despite craving the prestige of Harvard, his professors insisted Princeton was the ideal place for a career in abstract mathematics. His thesis advisor, Professor Richard Duffin, wrote a compelling recommendation letter to the head of Princeton's math department. "Mr. Nash is 19 years old and is graduating from Carnegie Tech in June. He is a mathematical genius." When he arrived at Princeton in 1948, he found himself at the center of the mathematical universe. Right next door was the Institute for Advanced Study, home to Einstein, Kurt Gödel, John von Neumann, and Robert Oppenheimer. Princeton's complete academic freedom, with no red tape, no course requirements, allowed the unconventional Nash to thrive. It wasn't Nash's 6'1" frame that made him stand out. It was his eccentric behavior. He was known for lying on library tables, deep in thought, or wandering the campus thinking while whistling Bach's Little Fugue. He skipped classes, preferring to learn by questioning his professors and students over afternoon tea at Fine Hall, the math department building. Though his classmates found him difficult to get along with, they admired his intellect and appreciated the game he introduced on campus, Hex. While Hex had been invented a few years earlier by Danish mathematician Piet Hein, Nash made it popular around Princeton, where it became known as Nash. The game was simple. The first person to connect the two opposite sides of the board first wins. Nash proved that the first player can always win if they make the best possible moves. The specific strategy depends on the board size and configuration. John von Neumann, one of the most influential mathematicians of the 20th century, came across Princeton students playing Hex, or Nash, as he made his way to his lectures. Known as the father of game theory, von Neumann co-authored a groundbreaking book focused on zero-sum games, where one person's gain is exactly the other's loss. Tennis is a classic example of a zero-sum game.
30-50.
But Nash believed zero-sum games were far too simplistic and explored games involving multiple players and potential cooperation. When Nash worked as a summer consultant at RAND Corporation, a think tank focused on nuclear strategy, he argued that even opponents shared a common interest, avoiding mutual destruction. He had the audacity as a grad student to request a meeting with von Neumann to present his proof of equilibrium in games, but von Neumann quickly dismissed it. Sylvia Nasser, author of A Beautiful Mind, a biography of Nash, describes how von Neumann abruptly interrupted him, saying, "That's trivial, you know, that's just a fixed point theorem." Von Neumann dismissed Nash's work as unoriginal. As Nasser wrote, "Von Neumann's rejection of Nash's bid for attention and approval must have hurt. he never approached von Neumann again.
Despite the rejection, Nash firmly believed in the significance of his work. He introduced a revolutionary concept in game theory called the Nash Equilibrium.
The prisoner's dilemma offers a simple example. Two people, Leandro and Diego, are arrested for a crime. If both deny their involvement, they each get 2 years in prison. If Leandro denies while Diego confesses, Diego gets 1 year while Leandro serves 10. If Diego denies while Leandro confesses, Diego gets 10 years while Leandro serves 1. If both confess, they each get 4 years.
According to John Nash, the most rational option, the Nash Equilibrium, is for both to confess because it's the strategy that minimizes their risk. Each prisoner confesses to avoid the risk of their partner betraying them, which would result in the harshest penalty of 10 years, even though both denying would lead to a better outcome of less jail time. When Nash introduced his equilibrium theory in 1950, his colleagues didn't think of it as particularly groundbreaking. His mentor, Albert Tucker, believed pure mathematics was not Nash's real strength. This perception likely influenced Nash's decision to focus on more abstract mathematical problems, leading to his groundbreaking work on manifolds. A manifold is a shape that looks flat up close, but reveals its curvature from a distance, like the Earth's surface. Nash wondered whether manifolds could be represented using mathematical equations. He proved that any smooth manifold, no matter how complex, could be closely approximated by polynomial equations. But this breakthrough on manifolds didn't secure him a job at Princeton because other professors didn't like him. Professor Emil Artin couldn't look past Nash's arrogant personality, thinking he was intellectually superior to everyone else. Plus, Nash didn't even like teaching, preferring to dedicate himself to research. MIT, however, wanted him. Nash became an instructor at MIT when he was just 23 years old, younger than many graduate students. It was at MIT that he made his most groundbreaking contribution to mathematics. During a conversation at MIT, Nash learned that the problem of embedding any Riemannian manifold into Euclidean space remained unsolved. A Riemannian manifold is a curved surface that, when viewed up close, appears flat, just like how the Earth feels flat when you stand on it, despite being a sphere. In this example, the blue region on the tube looks like a flat round disk when you zoom in. The yellow half circle near the edge becomes a flat half disk. The green curve on the boundary flattens into a straight line when examined closely. Nash worked in his office from 10 p.m. to 3 a.m. every weekday and on weekends, tackling the challenge of embedding curved surfaces, no matter how complex, into flat Euclidean space. In the end, he succeeded. He proved that any smooth Riemannian manifold can seamlessly fit into Euclidean space while preserving its geometric properties, like distances and angles. The Russian-American mathematician Mikhail Gromov called Nash's embedding theorem one of the main achievements of mathematics of the 20th century. Yet, for all the success, his personal life was a mess. He had no intention of marrying Eleanor Steer, a nurse he was secretly seeing and got pregnant, and didn't offer any financial support for their son, John David. Eleanor was forced to place the baby in foster care for a time. Nash had emotionally intense relationships with men, and is rumored to have been involved with an MIT graduate student named Jack Bricker. According to Sylvia Nasser's biography, Nash's friend recalled the two being openly affectionate, though Nash denied being gay. Rand Corporation fired him as a consultant after he was arrested at a public restroom near Santa Monica Beach for attempting to pick up an undercover police officer, which he denied. At the time, during the Cold War, gay people were seen as security risks as they could be blackmailed. His relationship with Jack ended when he met Alicia Lerde, one of the few women who studied physics at MIT. Alicia came from a prominent family in El Salvador that had emigrated to the US. She thought Nash was handsome and loved his beautiful mind even more. Nash admired her intelligence and the fact that she was chasing him. She got a job at the university library because she knew he liked to study there. They married in 1957 at an Episcopal church across from the White House, even though Nash was an atheist. Alicia's love, commitment, and resilience would soon be tested in Nash's darkest hour. Nash's mental illness began to surface while Alicia was pregnant in 1959. He was on sabbatical from MIT, spending a year at the Institute for Advanced Study, working on contradictions in quantum theory, the science of particles at atomic and subatomic levels. Nash later admitted that tackling such an overwhelming problem was possibly overreaching and psychologically destabilizing. He began to be consumed by delusions. He believed aliens or foreign governments were communicating with him through encrypted messages in the New York Times. He would switch from radio station to station, convinced they were broadcasting messages meant only for him. He thought men in red ties were sending him signals, dogs were following him, and he began staying up late writing strange letters to the United Nations and foreign governments. He painted black spots on the walls of his and Alicia's bedroom. Alicia tried to hide her husband's condition from his colleagues to protect his career. She would pick him up from work and stopped inviting guests over for dinner. But Nash's condition worsened, and he began threatening Alicia. She had no choice but to have him committed to a private psychiatric hospital in Massachusetts, where he was diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia. Nash appeared to improve after a few weeks and was discharged just 1 week after the birth of their son, John Charles. But Nash wasn't actually better. He abruptly quit his position at MIT and flew to France after receiving an invitation to lecture at the Collège de France in Paris. He and Alicia moved there, driven by his delusions of forming a world government, and left their baby in the care of Alicia's mother. In Europe, Nash decided to renounce his American citizenship in favor of becoming a citizen of the world. But when he went to the US Embassy in Luxembourg to give up his passport, an official thought he was insane and refused his request. He then hoped to claim refugee status in Switzerland, the European headquarters of the UN, but none of the officials there took him seriously either. Out of frustration, he destroyed his American passport. Ultimately, Swiss authorities issued Alicia a new passport, listing Nash as her dependent so they could return to Paris. Back in the French capital, police escorted Nash to Orly Airport, sending him back to America at the request of the US State Department. Alicia believed Nash might benefit from being near other mathematicians, so they settled in Princeton, where she took a job in the research division of the electronics company Radio Corporation of America to support them. But Nash didn't get better. He wandered barefoot into restaurants, referred to himself as Johann von Nassau, probably inspired by Princeton's Nassau Street, and carried a notebook labeled Absolute Zero. Alicia had him committed again, this time to a state institution in New Jersey, as she could no longer afford private care. Nash received insulin coma therapy, a controversial treatment. While Nash later blamed memory gaps on this therapy, he admitted that his time at the state psychiatric hospital helped him improve. But in Nash's mind, recovery came at a cost. He reflected, "One aspect of this is that rationality of thought imposes a limit on a person's concept of his relation to the cosmos." Nash briefly returned to research, publishing a paper on fluid dynamics in a French mathematical journal in 1962. But his mental health deteriorated again. Mentally and physically exhausted, Alicia made the difficult decision to divorce Nash. She believed he resented her for committing him to institutions and hoped that granting him freedom might help him heal. She was given full custody of their son. Nash spent more time in institutions where he was treated with antipsychotic medications. Following his hospitalization, he returned to Princeton University, where he was often seen wandering the hallways. Students said he seemed to be talking to the squirrels. He'd scribble nonsensical equations and messages on blackboards, such as, Mao Zedong's bar mitzvah was 13 years, 13 months, and 13 days after Brezhnev's circumcision. Alicia had tried to move on from Nash by starting a relationship with mathematician John Coleman Moore, but their relationship ended due to Moore's struggles with alcoholism and severe depression. In the 1970s, Alicia let Nash move in with her, knowing he had no one, and his sister Martha couldn't or wouldn't take on the responsibility. Allowing Nash to move in provided him with the stability and support he so desperately needed. They remarried in 2001. When asked why he believed his delusions, Nash later explained, "Because the ideas I had about supernatural beings came to me the same way that my mathematical ideas did, so I took them seriously." After nearly three decades of mental illness, Nash remarkably began to emerge from his delusions. He explained his transformation this way, "Then gradually, I began to intellectually reject some of the delusionally influenced lines of thinking. This began with a rejection of politically oriented thinking as essentially a hopeless waste of intellectual effort." He also attributed his recovery to his own effort. It can be analogous to the role of willpower in effectively dieting. If one makes an effort to rationalize one's thinking, then one can simply recognize and reject the irrational hypotheses of delusional thinking. As he reconnected with reality, the world began to notice his earlier groundbreaking work. The Nobel Committee considered Nash for the prize in economics for his work in game theory.
They first moved in at 4 a.m.
By the 1990s, game theory had become a major field with real-world applications in politics, economics, and biology. However, not everyone on the Nobel Committee was convinced that Nash should be honored. Committee member Ingmar Stahl raised concerns, reportedly saying, "He's sick. You can't have a person like that." However, Sweden's leading economist, Assar Lindbeck, persisted, telling Sylvia Nasser, "Nash was different. He had gotten no recognition and was living in real misery. We helped lift him into daylight. We resurrected him in a way. It was emotionally satisfying." In 1994, Nash shared the Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences. However, he was not invited to give a lecture, as is customary, likely due to concerns about his mental stability. Nash was aware that mathematics was often seen as a young person's game, but remained determined to make up for the decades lost to his illness. He said, "Statistically, it would seem improbable that any mathematician or scientist at the age of 66 would be able, through continued research efforts, to add much to his or her previous achievements. However, I am still making the effort, and it is conceivable that with a gap period of about 25 years of partially deluded thinking providing a sort of vacation, my situation may be atypical. Thus, I have hopes of being able to achieve something of value through my current studies or with any new ideas that come in the future." Although Nash never made significant new contributions to mathematics after his recovery, his earlier work continued to earn recognition. In 2015, he received the prestigious Abel Prize for his contributions to partial differential equations, including the Nash Embedding Theorems. However, 4 days after returning home from the awards ceremony in Norway, tragedy struck.
U.S. Nobel Prize winner mathematician John Nash has died in a car crash along with his wife Alicia.
Famed mathematician John Nash, whose accomplished life inspired the movie A Beautiful Mind, was killed in a crash on the New Jersey Turnpike.
The couple was heading from Newark to their home in Princeton when the driver of the taxi they were riding in lost control and slammed into a guardrail on the New Jersey Turnpike in Middlesex County. State police say Nash and his wife died instantly. Both, not wearing seatbelts, were thrown from the car.
John Nash was 86 and Alicia, 82. The world had lost one of the brightest minds of the 20th century and the remarkable woman who had stood by his side. If John Nash's story has inspired you to deepen your understanding of math or explore related fields like computer science, data science, or AI, Brilliant is the perfect place to start. Instead of passively watching lessons, you're actively solving problems so you truly understand concepts like algebra, calculus, and vectors. Whether you're brushing up on the basics or challenging yourself with advanced concepts, there's something for every skill level. You can also learn how to program by familiarizing yourself with Python and start building programs on day one with their built-in drag-and-drop editor. One of my personal favorites is how large language models work, which gives a fascinating behind-the-scenes look at the technology that powers tools like ChatGPT. And the best part is you can try Brilliant for free for 30 days by signing up using my link in the description, brilliant.org/newsthink, or scan the QR code on your screen. That's brilliant.org/newsthink for a free 30-day trial, plus you'll save 20% on an annual premium subscription. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.